I'd like to welcome and thank you all for making it out on this beautiful day to celebrate the life of Julieta Carpena. I would like to also ask that all guests, if you have a cell phone or electronic device, to please place them on silent. That way you do not disturb today's celebration. We will begin our service today with the worship of Noel and Grace. Please come forward.
Thank you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Holy God, we come to you today to put to rest one of your beloved daughters to whom you have called home to join you and many others who went ahead of her. Many of them were our mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, families, and friends. Father, we are here with sadness, especially Kuyadani and his kids and grandkids, because Ati Julie's presence will be missed here on earth. Although she was afflicted with the effects of the stroke, she remained faithful to you and brought love and joy to her family and friends. We thank you for her life as a wife, mother, grandmother, sister in Christ, and as a friend. Thank you for her gift of singing, which she used for as long as she could, praising you. Thank you that you've allowed her to live a long and blessed life with her soulmate and husband, Kuyadani. And he has a blessed life because you gave her the blessings of a faithful husband and loving children who took turns to take care of her until the end. For now, I know they are grieving, especially Kuyadani. I lived him first, Lord, during the first few days, months, living without her. I pray that your loving arms will comfort him in the days to come. They've been together as one for many years, and learning to live life without her will be a new thing. But because you are our great comforter and healer, I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit hold him and keep him safe and healthy. For all of the Ate Julie's children and grandchildren, I pray for comfort as well. I pray that they may find comfort with you and each other in the days to come. Guide them and give them wisdom and patience in helping their father finding his way to living a life without his wife, their mom. Ate Julie has run and finished the course. One day, after the mourning is over, and even today, we rejoice for the life she lived. As Christians and your followers, we find comfort that one day we will be with our loved ones in heaven, praising and worship you, Lord. Same comfort goes with the Cajudo family. Be with us, Lord, today. Bless our time together as we celebrate Ate Julie's life. We dedicate this service to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
The scripture reading for today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 55 to 58. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord and Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know your labor in the Lord is not in vain. May God bless the reading of his word.
Julieta Nanay Carpena Cajudo was born in Rizal, Laguna, Philippines, to her loving parents, Clemente and Soledad Carpena, on October 19, 1934. She was the eldest of four children. Nanay was gifted in singing, starting at a young age. Lolo Clemente would regularly bring her to church to sing with the choir as a soloist. It was her heavenly voice that captured the eye of one Daniel Tatay Cajudo. From then on, Tatay and Nanay fell head over heels for each other. But the story from Tatay was that he was actually courted by Nanay, since his family was lahi ng pikutin. In any case, they were married in 1956. A year after they were married, they had their first child, Rebecca. She was the most beautiful baby that was ever born. Auntie Rebbe made me write this. Since they had no TV and the internet wasn't invented yet, they had 6 more kids. You'd think they would have learned their lesson with the first one. So, after Rebbe, Ephraim, David, Loida, and Gideon were born. Then they rested for 5 years. After seeing the movie Sound of Music, they decided to add 2 more in order to be the Filipino Von Trapp family. And Noel and Jem were created to fill the gap. It turned out the most beautiful baby was Jem after all. Uncle Jem paid me to say this. Nanay was not only a loving wife, but a devoted mother. Raising a family with 7 kids was not easy, especially when Tatay was the only income earner. The whole family lived in a house the size of a typical garage in America, but Nanay made it a home. There was always food cooked 3 times a day. The world revolved around her husband, kids, and the kitchen. She was an excellent homemaker, and she cooked a lot. The house was clean, she stood by her husband, and she stood by her kids. She was a single mom at times, especially when Tatay immigrated to the United States. She continued to sing at Olongapo Church of Christ, then at First Christian Church Wilmington, and with the CCMP choir. She really reached those high operatic notes. Her love for her husband and her kids were attributable to her love for the Lord. Nanay was warmly approachable, and many confided in her. She was considerate, selfless, and encouraging. When a tragedy hit the family with Nanay's aneurysm that perpetually affected her memory, Nanay could no longer sing or reach those high notes. But God's grace was upon her because she remembers the good about her family and friends. For over 25 years, Nanay's tragedy was a blessing to all who knew her. She was able to bring joy to us all because every time you met her, she was always smiling, even when she calls you pangit or fat. But Nanay was not always congenial. You see, her memory also made her forget that she has eaten. You do not want to be in her line of fire when you forget to feed her. So her family kept her on a regimental meal and snack schedule. Her memory also brings her to the memory of her dad, Lolo Clemente. Many times, she easily confused between Tatay and Lolo. She would also look for her dad and sadden when we mentioned that he's already in heaven. She loved and missed her dad tremendously. Nanay was married to Tatay for over 60 years. She went home quietly to be with the Lord in the morning of August 3rd, 2016. In addition to Tatay, she is survived by her sister, Elizabeth Jovellano. She also leaves behind her 7 children and 14 grandchildren. Coincidentally, her mother, Lola Soledad, was also survived by 14 grandchildren when she went home to the Lord. Nanay's legacy will always live in her children and her grandchildren. It was through her selfless devotion to the family that she encourages us to do the same with our own families. While she is missed by all of us, it is comforting to know that she is united with Jesus and reunited with her parents and other siblings, relatives, and friends. We love you, Nanay, and we'll see you later. Now we're going to play a video to commemorate her life.
Thank you. Hello, good morning. I am, if you don't know me, I'm Rebecca Cajudo Gloria. I was the, according to my nana, I was the cutest baby ever. So I'm the oldest among seven of us. And I remember Nanay when we were growing up, she's the typical household mom and wife. She cleans the house all the time and she made sure that all of us will clean after us and everything. She will cook, she will do laundry, and I help her a lot of times too. But she will always be there for us. She makes sure that we go to school on time and everything. When Tatay came here to United States, he will send us some candies. And I remember this one time, we received some M&Ms, and she will distribute to all of us, especially to Jem and Noel. She will only give us 5 pieces each, because otherwise all of us will just keep eating all of the, especially the M&Ms, and we love all of that. So anyway, when she had the aneurysm, she lost all her short-term memories, and she remembers the one that was like 40, 50 years ago. So if I don't remember anybody, and I would just have to ask her, and she will just tell me who they are and everything. So that's one thing with her. And when she stayed with me, they were living with me for a few months, and she loves to come with me in the grocery. She loves to shop with me. She just loves to shop, going around. Now I don't have anybody to go around with me when I go grocery and everything, but she keeps me company and everything. Okay, thank you. We will miss her.
Si Nanay, hindi mo nakita ang malungkot ng time na yun. One time kasi mahilig ako sa matamis. One time si Nanay na bukas ng kondensada na gatas. Pagkatapos, nakita ko habang nanonood ako ng TV, nakita ko nagbukas siya. Tapos maya't-maya, pag nakakalingat siya, punta ako agad doon, inumin ko, tunggain kong gano'n. Tapos maya-maya nung pagbalik niya uli, paghawak, magtitimpla ng gatas, biglang gumangal, tumilapon. So yun yung mga naalala ko na ako na yung mga nakakatawang pangyayari kay Nanay. Tapos nung one time na pagkatapos ng surgery, hindi naman namin alam na nagwala na yung mga memory niya. So nakapaligid kami sa kanyang hospital bed. So tinignan niya lahat ng mga anak niya, paligid. Eh, noong time na yun, flat top yung buhok ko. Tapos skinny. Mukhang in-check. Sabi niya gano'n, may anak ba akong hapon? Lahat nagtawa na dahil hindi ko rin alam na gano'n na pala siya na meron ng lapse. At tapos, one time, noong sumunod na araw, medyo nakakaupo na siya sa hospital bed. Nakatingin siya sa bintana, sabi, David, kunin mo yung kinula ko. Tingin ko sa bintana, kinula. Hindi ko alam dahil akala ko nagbibiro lang. Kinula, tapos sabi ko, wala, ano na, nakuha ko na para lang tumigil na. Then, the following day, another one, sabi niya, David, tingnan mo nga yung sinain ko, yung mga araw-araw niya ginagawa. Kunin mo yung sinain ko. Tingnan mo, ay, sunog, ay, tatanga-tanga ba? Sabi ko, kaya yung mga naalala ko na nakakatawa. Kasi kung magsiserious ka naman, kukulubot pala. Ilang, 1 minute na yun.
Okay, the goal is not to cry, so that would be unglamorous if we cry all here. So anyway, when we were putting together, so we had to go back for our pictures, old pictures for the slide. So there were two things that struck me, because there are two things that I kind of regret, that when Tatay and Nanay asked me to go with them in Alaska, me and Atureb, basically for financial reasons or time at work, we weren't able to go. Another occasion that they asked us to go with them was in Hawaii. They stayed there for 14 days. We weren't able to go also for financial reasons and schedule at work, all that stuff, and there's not enough vacation. And I know when they went to Alaska, Nanay need help, and it was Rodney, actually, and Rusina and Lani that helped them. And they have 7 children, and we were not there. When they went to Hawaii, Nanay got lost in Hawaii. So somehow she was able to make it back to the cruise ship without Tatay. But had we been there, this, you know, could not have happened. So just as a lesson learned from our experience is, if you have a ailing parent, you know, when they ask you to go, to the extent that you're working, financial reasons should never be the reason, because they really just needed your help. They needed your presence there. They need your help. And come to think of it, if you have financial reasons because you could not go, you know, my brother, Noel, right there, he's rich. He'll finance your stuff.
Hello, everyone. I'm Epps Cajudo. No. No. I'm Chito. I'm one of Auntie Juliet's favorite. Probably last night everyone was saying Auntie always said them pangit, mataba, but I never got those words from Auntie. She always says, "You're not ugly, pero pangit." Anyway, I just want to thank Auntie Juliet and her family for, because they're the one who helped us when we were starting, and they've been there for us every time. And I didn't recall that much Auntie before she had her dementia. Or the only thing I remember way back then, when she went to visit in the Philippines, she always said to Nanay, "Here, the pasalubong. Sayo to, yun to, yun na yan, yan, gusto mo yan. You want this bed? Here, say." Those things that I remember to Auntie. And one thing I would miss now to Auntie is every time I see her, she always kind of giggle, excited. And I always kind of pinch her on her cheek, because she has a chubby cheek. And every time I have food, she says, "Oh, what is that? Ooh, I want that." And those things I would miss to Auntie. She's joyful and love you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gideon. I'm the 5th child, and out of the sibling, I'm the only one born at Kaiser Permanente. Sorry, it's just a joke. Actually, I'm born at St. Jude in Orange County. Anyway, Nana is true a Christian. You know, we saw her. She loved the Lord and everything. And one thing that highlights that I could remember, when she started cooking, you know, and she loves fresh food. So she'll buy a real chicken. You know, she doesn't like those prepared chicken already, because she always said that they inject water in there. So she buys the real chicken. So before before lunch, our house is kind of noisy because of the chicken. And she showed us how to slash the throat and everything, skin it and everything. And while it's still, still alive, the blood all over. And we cook it and we eat it, you know, so fresh. And then sometimes she buys the frog, of course. She chop the head, the frog, and then we eat the frog, you know. Well, of course, we cook it first. May adobo and paksiw, you know. And that's how she is. Yeah, she loves fresh food. That's all I can share. Okay, the Kaiser Permanente joke is done. Thanks. Hi, good morning. If you don't know me, I'm Noel. So I'm Nanay's most favorite son. I think that goes without saying. But, you know, one thing I remember about Nanay is that she's never been demonstrative of her faith. I know she sang at the with Lolo before he preached, and sang at the choir, sang solo. But I've never really seen her witness to anybody or lead a women's Bible study group. I don't remember her reciting any memory verse, anything like that to us. Although I think he does hate one verse that Jesus said, like, man does not live by bread alone. You know, because you know Nanay, you know, she loves to eat. And she doesn't like that verse at all. But I've always seen her by her husband's side. And Nanay was always in the background. And you really never seen the fruits of her labor. Except through the fruits of others, what they produce. What I mean is, Nanay might not show her devotion to the Lord, but all you have to do is to take a look at what Tatay, a great man as he is, has accomplished, and how her children turned out. Well, maybe not Ate Lloyd, you know, that's a bad example. Sorry, you know, everybody has a bad apple, you guys know that. I'm just kidding. It's not the Reb. but really, Nanay's debilitating condition, health, though tragic to the eyes of this world, was allowed by God and a blessing to us. Why? Well, so that we, her family and her friends, are given the opportunity. Nanay's perpetual smile towards others. Her love for the family and her passion for food gave us the opportunity to react and put our faith in action, to appreciate what we have and to live one day at a time. Thanks. I want to share a story with Nanay that probably nobody's ever heard of. After surgery, we found out that she couldn't be left alone. She just can't leave her alone. That was back in 1991. And a few months after, it was just me and her. And I had a job then. I had a part-time job at night, and I had to go to work. But I knew Tatay would come home like 30 minutes later, so I had like 30 or 45 minutes later. So I had like 45-minute gap. Okay, she'll be alone by herself. You know, nothing should happen, you know. But I told her before I left, I go, Nanay, whatever you do, I'm going to leave. I have to go to work. Whatever you do, don't cook. Wag kayong magluluto. Okay, sabi Nanay. Yeah, Jim, sige, hindi ako magluluto. Sige, basta pumasok ka. Sabi ko, wag kayong magluluto. Okay. So I went to work. First thing I did, I called her up. Nay, ano ginagawa niyo? Eto, nagluluto. And I'm like, oh no. So, you know, that's just a funny story. But I just want to share that Nanay, she wasn't great because she took care of us. She wasn't great because she played no favorites. She wasn't great because she loved Tatay so much. She was great because she surrendered her life to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ lived his life through Nanay. So whenever you saw Nanay for all your life, it was really Jesus Christ living his life through Nanay. And for the past week, I've been wondering how it was with him and God when she met God. And I think God asked her, she loved that song, How Great Thou Art. She used to sing that when we were kids. She used to sing that with Tatay. She used to sing that at Wilmington, and she would hit those high notes, you know? And, you know, those, whatever. And you better not be holding like a wine glass, you know, and she's doing,
you know, or else you'd be like, oh, she sings so beautifully. You know what I mean? It was just crap, you know? So I think God asked her, you know, could you, Julia, could you sing that song? Could you sing that song for me? And Nana's response would be, Lord, all my life I've been practicing that song to sing it for you today. I think she says something like that. And then after she sings it beautifully, she asks God, God, can I ask you a question? God would say, sure, anything. Kailan tayo kakain? That's all. Thank you.
Good morning. Today, my name is Greg Betson, and I have known Sister Juliet for about 4 years. And often when she could, she'd come to First Christian Church of Carson, and I got to see her then and talk to her then, and she was always, you know, was always full of encouragement. Even if I felt like I had a bad message, she would always tell me that she liked my sermon, and she was just awesome. But anyways, I want to share with you, I'm led to remind you of two things this morning. That it's both a time to rejoice and it's also a time to mourn. If we only focus on celebration, where our beloved is, we can forget to mourn, or worse yet, feel guilty about mourning later. Likewise, if we completely focus on the loss we feel now, that Sister Juliet has joined the Lord, we mourn and forget that we have a reason to celebrate during this time. Therefore, to mourn or to celebrate at this time, you have permission to do both. One of these things that Jesus preached during the Sermon on the Mount was that, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs was the kingdom of God. The word blessed would have better been translated divine joy, perfect happiness, and that these things belong to and are rewarded to those who are poor in spirit. I've had the privilege, like I said, of knowing her for about 4 years, and she was somebody that was poor in spirit, in my opinion. And what I mean by poor in spirit is that it's when a person knows that they can do nothing without God. They can do nothing without God in their lives. When they understand that they would have nothing good if it wasn't for God in their lives. And someone who holds on to the promise of eternal life that comes through having faith in Jesus Christ. In the 14th chapter of the Gospel of John, we find Jesus fully aware of his time on earth that's coming to an end. He knows his life on this earth is going to be over soon. And he's trying to prepare his disciples and talk to his disciples about it. And they fully don't comprehend everything that he's saying and trying to get across to them. But they are distressed because one thing that they do understand is that he is going to leave. And they're not going to have him around. And so, sensing their distress, Jesus told them, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. My Father's house has plenty of room. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas, one of the disciples, asked him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will also know my Father. This was not only a promise made to the disciples during that time, but it was also a promise made to Sister Juliet and all of those who choose to have faith in Jesus Christ. And it not only refers to the second coming of Jesus, but also for those of us who would pass away here on earth before the second coming comes. And it's a time to rejoice because Jesus has specifically prepared a place for Nanay in heaven, in paradise, and she is with him for all eternity. She is a generous woman. She faithfully followed the Lord, from what I hear, to the best of her ability. And from what I saw, she sought to please God in her thought life, her words, her actions. She's always encouraging, always uplifting. I never remember a discouraging word from her. I always remember her for those encouragements that she would give. I mean, sometimes I understand that she had her her disease, but you know, there's more than that. Like there's God in her, and I don't know. I just sensed that and was encouraged by that. Sister Juliet loved the Lord and her family and others, and you know, she'll be remembered for that, and also for the childlike faith that she had. If you think about it, a well-behaved child encourages you, right? They uplift you. They bring you joy, a joy that's contagious. They love you like they've never loved, like they love you like they've never been hurt before. And there's a faith in God that's simple, trusting, obedient, humble, and powerful. And that's what I would say that Sister Juliet had. But can you imagine the kingdom of God where our loved one is right now? She stands before the King of Kings and the God of Righteousness. If you know Jesus Christ and you can think of the one time you were praying and you felt the closest to Him, it's nothing compared to what it will be like face to face before Him. In His presence, just saturated in his love and all that He is. Worshiping with the other saints and other loved ones that have gone before us and His angels. And it's so amazing. I don't think that any of us can fully comprehend. But I'll tell you one thing: it sure is something to rejoice about. You know, that sure is something to rejoice about. You know, and more than that, going before the throne of God, and Jesus getting up from His throne, coming to you, and saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You did well in the life that I gave you. I'm pleased with you. I'm proud of you. You know, thank you." And just to have that honor, I think would be more powerful than... There would be no approval from anyone else that would even compare. That would just be the greatest blessing. And I believe that, you know, she experienced that. You see, it's not about being perfect. It's about never giving up on our faith in Christ, no matter what. Finishing the race, as the Apostle Paul calls it, at all costs, and not only finishing it, but finishing it well. We rejoice because Nanay is in a place completely absent of sickness, disease, discomfort, sin, and death. We rejoice because those of us who have chosen to believe in Jesus Christ are assured the same promise waiting for us. And not only that, when it's our turn to leave this earth, we get to reunite with our loved ones once again. In fact, I think that they'll be waiting for us at the gates of heaven. And so we celebrate because in Christ, death is not the end, but only the beginning. Jesus said that blessed are those who are poor in spirit, and blessed are those who mourn, because in their brokenness they cry out to God for relief, wisdom, direction, strength, healing, and most of all for comfort. So blessed are the poor in spirit because they know that they're broken. Nothing they do can help them get over what they're going through or get them through what they're going through, and they know that and they come before Him. Well, blessed are they because they'll experience God and they'll experience His presence and power in their lives and Him helping them through that. Blessed are those that mourn because theirs is the kingdom of God. When we're broken and come before Him and mourn, He is able to come in with His Spirit and comfort us and strengthen us. And we would be encouraged to, whenever we mourn, to ask the Holy Spirit to guide us in it. Because then we know we don't do it too much. And then we know that we do it enough. And we know that He's walking us through it, you know, hand in hand. This is a time to rejoice, and this is a time to mourn. Be empathetic toward one another. Love one another. And rejoice with one another. mourn with those today that are mourning, celebrate with those today that are celebrating, and realize that more than anything, the celebration that we have because of where she is and the love that she had for all of us. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for Nanay and your love that we saw through her, that we experienced. May we have the same kind of love. May we have the same kind of childlike faith. Thank you for guiding us when we mourn and even when we celebrate. Help us to be balanced, Lord, and just walk with us hand in hand through this. You are close to the brokenhearted. We just give you thanks for this person. Thanks for the promise that is in you, Jesus, that our loved one is with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, we are just so very thankful for this time that we're able to not only mourn, but Father, just celebrate Dean on Juliet's life. Father, we are just so thankful for your blessings. We're thankful for your Holy Spirit that's also our comforter. Father, during this time, I pray that you'll just bless and just give Nino and Danny comfort. Father, I pray that you'll give the children comfort. Rebbe, Epps, Dave, Loida, Gideon, Noel, and Jim. Father, I'm thankful for the 14 grandchildren. And Father, the fact that so many have been blessed. Father, what an incredible witness in this time that they've been married for so long. And Father, especially in this time and age where that is so rare. Father, I'm thankful for that witness, that powerful testimony. And I just pray that you'll be with us and just give us comfort during this time. We thank you and we praise you for her life. And we know that she is at your right-hand side. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thanks, Brother Pete. On behalf of my dad and our whole family, just want to really thank you for each one of you for sharing this special day with us. A day of celebrating Nanay's life, a day celebrating her voyage home. And we can't thank you enough for the friends and families that help us out through these 2 days, who are working at the backstage, in a way, to make these 2 days smooth and less stressful as it is for us, for our family. We love you all. Please stand by for the funeral director to give us further instruction for the committal service.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we have arrived to the conclusion of our service here in the chapel for Julieta. We're going to continue today's beautiful day by continuing her celebration at the gravesite. Before we do so, I want to offer all of you a last chance to come forward and pay your respects to her one last time. Afterwards, I'm going to ask that the doors to the left will be open and that you please exit those doors. After the family has had their chance to spend with Julieta, I'm going to allow the pallbearers to bear the casket to the funeral coach that is parked in the family circle. Afterwards, I will drive the funeral coach to the front where all of your vehicles are parked. I ask that you do not remove your vehicles until the funeral coach passes you by and you may all follow behind so that we can go on a procession over to the gravesite. Our gravesite is not nearby, so we are going to be doing the driving procession. Starting with those in the back rows, I ask that you come forward as the escort in the back will bring you, and that all pallbearers stay in the chapel after you have paid your respects for further instructions. Thank you very much. Starting now, you will be escorted forward.
Thank you. Para
island of